So, good evening. Yeah, all the newcomers, please sit here in the front. Everybody is trying to grow back. So, as your half the colleagues have already attended that. So, my task is to say the first sentence same and the last sentence same. In between, of course, I cannot promise that I will say the same thing. So the whole idea I was trying to communicate with the first batch is to what is the role of a effective English in defining the problem. And therefore, I take the liberty of talking to CA students, though it is not my field. I am an electronic engineer and have done physics for most of my career, experimental physics. So I think you have to bear with some examples which are more common, easy to understand for me, and then you have to actually identify your problems in a similar way at a later stage. Because if I talk about programming and various other aspects of computer science, then my knowledge is very little. So let us get on with a research problem. We saw on Monday's lecture last that there is a 5-step process. So define the problem, then define the hypothesis, plan the experiment, make observations, make analysis and see whether you have achieved the target goal, which is the hypothesis. So hypothesis is like a PhD problem which your guide is supposed to give, but invariably the guide gives you a topic and then he asks you to do what is called a literature survey. And the literature survey is supposed to make a background, ready background for you. If you are an M.Tech student, it is for a M.Tech 1-year project. For a PhD student, it is like a 3-to-4-year activity. So let's say how effectively we can actually pose the problem and later fill in all the details which you get through this literature survey and various other coursework that you do. So I will begin by two examples from what we know as the thinkers in the field, Stephen Covey. You might have heard of his famous book of 7 Habits of Effective People. And one of the important thing is begin with the end in mind. So that means you have to begin your thesis with a wonderful PhD problem. That is what it means. You can't begin at the beginning and as you grow, you first start walking, then you start slowly walking faster, then you start running slowly and then you start running faster. Your target should be that you have to win the Olympic 100 meter gold, right? So that's called the begin with the end in mind. So what is our end in mind? My research problem should be a very good problem, and if you should solve it, there will be an achievement of some kind. Very similar thing was told by another group of authors, Nadler and Hibino, and their book is also Breakthrough Thinking. And they say that whatever you are doing, your solution should be having this property called uniqueness, and the second one is called solve the next problem. So let me at the outset say that in any PhD or any research, there are only exactly two aspects. First, you have to define the problem, and at the end of your activity, you get a solution, or you get several solutions of which you claim one is a very good solution. So you have a problem and a solution, but unfortunately for you, you can't do it on day one or beginning of the project, because the human brain thinks in different ways. The left brain is full of ideas and the right brain is more of facts. whether really you got a solution, whether we can do this here, whether we have enough resources here, whether I have enough time here, whether I will understand everything that is required. So that actually limits you. That is a fact-finding side of the brain which actually looks at every solution, whether you can do it or whether you will do it well and so on. So I think at the time of defining the problem, let's use only the left brain. And let's divide this as, when you use the left brain, the assumption is that you can't use the right brain and vice versa. So that means for defining, we should use only the left brain. At that time, we should not worry about the solution, because I have already put a restriction, axiomatic restriction, that you can use only one side of the brain. So this lecture is about using the left side of the brain. We will not worry about a solution. We'll only talk about the problem. How many types of problem can I have? How will I actually very correctly write a problem in simple English? Because this course is a communication, so I must be able to actually postulate a problem in very good English, that you can understand, guide can understand, and everybody will understand what you are trying to do. So the PhD problem is like a research problem. So pardon me if there are more than half the people M.Tech, so you just assume that for the moment you are a PhD student, doesn't matter. So a research topic is good for both M.Tech and PhD.
90% are
M.Tech. So we'll say research problem, not a PhD problem. So a research problem. So we have to create a mission statement. Or what we call the goal. So goal or objective is like I want to go to the moon, and the scope of activity is I have to make a launcher for taking me to that, correct? I have to make a rocket. So that's the scope of activity. The goal is that I want to go to the moon. So like that, the mission statement is that there is a mission that I want to first determine the best research problem, and once I get a fix on that, then I will find several ways of finding solutions, the good, the bad, the ugly, and then we will find the right solution. But when we attempt to solve this, we should have, or even in the title of this PhD or research problem, we should have this question: what is novel in it? What is the novel in the problem itself? We are not yet found, or you are not even thinking about the solution. What is the novel or non-obvious? In the problem itself. That means it must be a striking problem. So few of the examples which I will cite later, I will give you right now. So I say that my PhD is on solar cooling. So we know solar energy is heat, and I am talking of cooling, it's opposite. Or my problem is virtual reality. The reality is a reality and virtual is not a reality, right? But I now combine this and I say I am working on virtual reality. Or I am working on reconfigurable hardware. Hardware is supposed to be hardware, right? Not supposed to change it. But now we say we want to change it, configurable hardware. And after several theses done on configurable hardware, then of course we have to invent another word called reconfigurable hardware. So these are the kinds of titles that should impress us. Otherwise, in my physics career, I found most of the PhD problems were some aspects of ferroelectricity in this. Some aspects of something means a dudder, you know. So already I reject it as anything novel, because I don't even want to read it. If you say some aspects of 3D printer, but 3D printer is good. Anybody heard of a 3D printer? Have you heard of 3D print? Okay, I have decided not to ask questions to the first row people. Okay, I welcome them. Third row, blue shirt. Have you heard of 3D printer? You. Anybody has heard of 3D printer? Yeah, please tell. Correct. So I can give a drawing of a pen like this and ask the 3D printer to print, it will print a pen 3D. So it's very difficult to imagine somebody who is familiar with a printer to imagine what is a 3D printer. So that is why these titles are very, very amazing titles. And now it is a reality, you can buy it for $599. You will get the object of your desire, you know, printed. Secondly, will there be, that's another question, a eureka moment? I mean, we don't want it to become a dull or a dumb squib, you know. Somewhere down the line, got it. So that means your problem is quite tough and having achieved a solution, any solution, is a eureka moment. If you give a very simple problem like some aspects of ferroelectricity, if you get a result as good as anybody else, you will be okay. There's no thrill in that. So I think your title is very, very novel or has a mixture of these opposite sounding words, then we are going to get a thrill out of it. And then we'll definitely expect a thrilling session with the research. Exactly.
Visualization. Visualize your brain and you will actually win.
Yeah. So, begin with the end in mind. You must always have the dream. The dream is at the top of your. You will win. Because I am telling you, Olympic, you may not win the 100 meter gold, but if you give a PhD title or research title, you will solve it. That
is
enough.
Very important.
See, I have written every slide, at the top of it, it says begin with the end in mind, that's it. That's the dharma of research problem definition. Nowhere you forget, the goal should be high.
So, if you aim low, you reach low.
Reach even lower actually, yeah. So, let us try to make the best of our time available. So, let us say the end goal must be a top goal, right? So, what are the goals like in a researcher's mind? I am going to write a list of goals. My handwriting becomes a little smaller as I proceed. That's why I requested some people to come forward, but I am going to read it anyway. So, one, to find a solution to a difficult or what we call or world's problem. So, your literature survey is not meant to find out what people have done and you also do similar thing. The literature survey is you are supposed to find what they have not done. Yet, you have to find out what they have not yet done, which you should do. Two, publish a paper in Nature or Science. What is so great about Nature? I mean, it has got a very high index, some, you know, 20, 30 like that. So, what is a Nature paper? It is like this, if something has been done in nature, like every duck has got webbed fingers and it can swim in the pool in a free way, or every bird, every sparrow has got only 10 grams of wings, the feathers, but somehow that 10 grams support 150 gram of the weight of the sparrow, it can fly. So, sometimes you wonder, you know, how you do that. So, that is the wonder. So, if you wondered about a tough problem and you find a solution, they say, I have found the solution, then you can go and publish in the Nature, because Nature is all about solving some wonderful such phenomena. Then the next one is publish many papers in top journals. I won't ask you why you want to publish so many papers in top journals, because the next line says so. Do a good thesis or good enough thesis so that I will get a postdoc in MIT, Stanford, Berkeley, Cambridge, etc. Right? That is why we want to publish in top journal. If not this, then of course finish in time before your scholarship drops to zero, or final is get a job. And of course it means bye bye to research. So if you don't do anything about it, it's like a pendulum is going to fall down with gravity. This gravity is going to pull you down if you don't do anything about it. I know people used to join TIFR with the hope of getting a Nobel Prize. Later they said, at least one paper in Nature. Oh no, okay, some papers in IEEE or whatever is your association. Then a good thesis within quotes. Your guide says it is a good thesis or some nonsense like that. And then of course finish it in 6 years. That was considered as good time, because after that the scholarship is not there. And finally get a good job. So I used to tell myself as well as my colleagues, younger colleagues later, that I don't know, you do something to stop this sliding down. Then I was so particular, I kept on telling one fellow I thought who was bright. So finally, he reached Stanford, that's good. I mean, somewhere it has to stop, right? Otherwise, it will slide down all the way. Then you wonder that why so many M.Tech students lose interest after December. Because the placement has been done and the job has nothing to do with their M.Tech thesis and they are lost. But I tell them, I mean, the job is already acquired, but why can't you finish this project nicely? The project is interesting, you might as well finish it, isn't it? Instead of lounging around in front of the TV, and no, there are mattresses there, that's fine. But it doesn't mean that in the last 4 months you lounge around there and do nothing. So please do something about it so that there is no downward trend. So end goal is the top. So what do you do in, let's say, the initial period, what we call the literature survey? So what you do is, you read everything. Sorry for drawing this brick wall opposite to the way it is constructed. During construction it goes from bottom to top. But this is the way we do literature survey. We read papers in 2012 first, and then in 2009, then in 2001. And maybe 1995, like that. We do the literature survey in the reverse way, which is okay. So what we do there is, you try to find a gap. They say, okay, my object is to publish 2 papers here. So people have left these gaps and you fill up the gaps. But that's not going to agree with my original definition of defining your research problem as a top goal. Mission. So we say we'll do it. We'll find some excuse for doing this also, because that's the interesting part, is that human mind is a wonderful phenomena by the God, that it finds justification or gratification in doing anything and everything. So I keep on telling you, you must try to work for a Nobel Prize or Fields Medal or whatever it is. But I will also like you to publish some faltu papers also. There's no harm done. So I'll tell you how to fill up these gaps and publish papers, but that's not the goal. Your job is to make a new structure in which some other stupid people will fill up the gaps, isn't it? So you have to now make a structure which is new, and that's the whole business about the top goal. The research goal is make a new structure. So I am told, for example, in computer science, the only great thing that has been done in last 20 years, that is what I am told, is what is called the design patterns. I am going to, in another 10 minutes, I am going to give you these pairs of words which are very interesting, like 3D printer and virtual reality and solar cooling, you know, exactly opposite meanings. So you see any opposite meaning here? The design means you have got the freedom to do it whichever way you want, but the patterns means there are a fixed number of patterns. So this gang of four found some patterns and they have made a list of patterns, and they now say, oh, there is nothing more to think about. These 17 patterns or whatever that number is, that's all is required. So that's called top research. Because now you are defining, you have taken away the thrill of doing new designs, because you must now use their 17 or whatever that number of patterns is, and all programs will be written perfectly. So I think there is something that everybody does, you have to move exactly in opposite direction and kill that, the routine activity what I call. So what we call this called a routine is the routine research. And we solve these contradictory things are going in opposite direction, and you find that conflict and solve that conflict, you are away from the routine. I am very happy to hear that tune well before the birth of your father, maybe. It is such an old song. From Nayadaur. Okay, so now we are back there. We always have this top that begin with the end in mind. So that's our title for the day, begin with the end in mind. So question one, when we are at it, defining our problem, question one, are you solving the wrong problem? Well, that is the biggest worry. You may do all of the work and then in the end somebody will say, oh, but that was not the right problem to solve, because there are things called right problem and wrong problem. And therefore, I am going to define what is a wrong problem, and therefore opposite to that is a right problem. So take an example. So I do consultancy with Mahindra tractors. So there is a problem called tractor bonnet, which is painted nice and red, you know, you have seen those tractors, has corrosion over time. So you get corroded and you suddenly start seeing some rusty patches on that, and then it spoils the whole show. So they have taken this task to find out what is the cause of it and then solve it. So the sequence of events is like this. One, they find that the during electrochemical deposition, because electrochemical deposition is the best way you can do it. So you have this primer on the steel part, you put a primer on which you are going to put the paint. The primer is done by electrochemical deposition. So as soon as the primer has a say coat of 1 micron or 2 microns, it becomes insulating, and wherever there is a pinhole, that means the bare metal is visible to the electrolyte, the electrochemical deposition occurs there. So now you see this wonderful thing, that it itself finds where there is a bare metal and fills it up, plugs it up. So that means at the end of this ECD deposition, there will be no bare metal by definition, right? The current will automatically die down to a particular low value, and that shows that now you have got a perfect primer deposition. That's very good, but there's a bigger problem because of the shape of the bonnet like that, and then there is a tackle with which you hold it, and this is the electrolyte. When the electrolyte is slowly filling up, there is an air bubble, trapped air. Now you have a trapped air, and of course the electro deposition will not occur there, and then that's the point where it will start the problem. The trapped air could be in anything which has got a small, suppose you have got a small welding or something like this, then there will be a trapped air here also, trapped air. So anything you give for holding that bonnet down finally with a, you know, that rubber clamp or whatever it is, there is a possibility of air being trapped. So what they do is, for this trapped hole, trapped air, and this because of the shape of the bonnet, you can do nothing about it. So what you do is you insert a tube, and this is the production, so the tube is also of metal, steel, insert a tube and remove this air. So the problem has been fixed. But then the tube gets plated with the primer, and the tube being tube, which is very small, slowly clogs, and then you have to clean it. So third one is the tube gets coated, get coats, and therefore clogs. So now we have to have a brush. At the end of every shift, you have to brush it and clean it. And the brush has to be strong because it has to remove the primer and then again do that plating again. So there was no such brush because this tube had a, this tube was coming and had a bend like that, you know, a nice natural bend. So you have to have a very flexible but steel like springy wire which can bend like this and has have bristles on it. So the solution to that problem was design a new brush, with the spring steel wires and the very hard material bristles. And then they solve, or they are solving that problem, and then when I went there, I said, oh, this is not the right problem, the wrong problem. I said, what is wrong with that? I said, it is doing nothing with the original problem. So that means the guideline therefore is, you agree that it is the wrong problem to solve? The original problem is miles away. If somebody is designing a brush, you will not even get an idea of what was the original problem, they have forgotten. And therefore, we always say that you solve, you must solve the original problem. So our whole stake is on this word original. That means right in the beginning, first 6 months, you must postulate your problem and must stick to it. On the way to the solution, you may find some secondary problems or solutions having drawbacks, etc. We can't do anything. So this tube coats and clogs is called a drawback of the solution, that particular solution by which the air was being taken. So my suggestion to them is, make a small hole, 1 millimeter hole or several 1 millimeter holes, and finally when you paint it, you can close that hole. It's too small to be seen, and so on. They say, no, no, design change. I say, but that putting tube also is a design change. So they hide behind this extraneous criteria that it is a design change and so on. So you might also do the same. Instead of solving the right problem, you will solve the wrong problem in a detail, and somewhere in the third year, one of the internal examiners will say, don't you think, professor, that we have to change the title? The title of the thesis? Naturally, isn't it? We have to change the title of thesis. So you are very meticulously trying to solve that problem now. You have forgotten the original problem. So let's not do that. So let's define the tough problem and stick with it. Or even if you solve intermediate difficulties, you must keep going back to it. Keep going back to it. So my advice is always solve the original problem and not the drawbacks of a particular solution. which you will also get involved. So, original problem was how to eliminate the trapped air, and there are ways of eliminating trapped air. My better suggestion, I think, was make a few holes at the critical points and later on close those holes with the paint itself. So, now we want to use good English to define a tough problem. So, what is the meaning of good English? The good English is only noun, verb and noun. All the adjectives and proverbs and all that and any clauses we shun, because they actually dilute or divert the problem. So, we are going to define a problem in that simplicity of a noun, verb and a noun. So, there are three such jobs. In simple English, very, very simply I have to say, the air is causing corrosion. Air causes ultimately corrosion. The road erodes the tire. So, as simply as that, your problem should be mentioned in that way. So, one is mention your problem. There are three ways. Problem in as a conflict. As a conflict in two desirable parameters called A and B. So, say I have a problem that I have got a huge program with hundreds of modules and I have to integrate with so many other modules at the user end and so many other modules at the final customer end, and then I am in the middle of it. So, first is that I have to be sure that all my modules talk to each other properly. Then the front module which interacts with the customer entry point also talks nicely, and finally I give the end result the way the user wants finally. So, one is my own modules and the other one is interface with everybody else, let us say both are desirable. But what happens is the more I do on this, this becomes poorer. The more modules and more things I do, more likely than not that it becomes difficult to integrate with anybody else. Then I say okay, let us keep the integrability as a standard objective, and then I get a limitation on my own modules, because my module must exactly have that format, etc. So, I think we have to solve this problem, perennial problem forever. So, you have a huge big program like SAP, and then it must be naya paisa perfect, right? And in billions of dollars or trillions of dollars of things are going through that program and still must not give an error of even 1 cent. So, that is the difficulty, and not a single customer should be unhappy. So, that has become the a big challenge, and therefore, in my problem you define what are the two conflicting requirements. If I do something, if I try to improve B, then A has a problem. If I improve A, then B has a problem. So, one of the classic problems in microprocessor is if you increase the speed, right, gigahertz, and you increase the number of cores in a package, 4 core, no? Now we get a 4 core microprocessor. So, that is the good, we say A is good. So, increasing the speed A is good, but then the power dissipation is a problem. B become bad. I do not have a red pen, so you have to bear with it. So, what is the VLSI designer doing? Who is designing the chip? He is just putting more and more and more and more components on the chip, and the speed is increasing. And half C V square F, so F is the frequency and C is bigger, if the chip is bigger, half C V square F. So, now we got to reduce the voltage, but you cannot do it indefinitely. So, you got this power dissipation. Even 10 years ago that Pentium 100 megahertz, used to have a fan sitting on that, you remember, inside. That main processor chip had a separate fan inside there, and now of course it was only 10 or 20 watt, now it is more than 200 watts, and very soon it will become 1 kilowatt. So now you have got a bomb inside your microprocessor, the bomb is inside your laptop. So now you have got a cooling jacket for laptop. So how are you going to solve this problem? It is not a electrical engineering problem, it is a heat transfer problem. So one of my favorite students from mechanical engineering joined Stanford University integrated circuit lab, and he was working on the heat removal from this integrated circuit chips, because it is a tough problem. So you don't want to change your design activity, you can't do that easily. So you hire somebody who can solve the heat dissipation problem, so he is the champion. So invariably in any technology, the focus of the current research actually moves from one field to another field to another field. And you cannot keep on saying that computer science is one such thing with a fixed idea. The focus of that activity can go to communication between computers, or getting utilization of this computing power in the world through cloud computing or like. So this focus keeps on changing, and therefore you have to know where the focus is, where the crunch is. So you have to say, this is important and I got to do something with that. The second one is that software must be easy to use. This is a very favorite example. A 4 year old can work on it, and it must have complex features. So that's Windows for you. A 4 year old can use it, just like 60 year old like me also can use it. I spend 20 hours a week on the computer, but I don't understand what it is, right? You may drive a car for all your life and may not know how the engine works. So it is like that. We are using it only as a end product. We have got pen drives, we don't have to know what is inside there. So we keep on using it. But then it is affected by virus. So we have got Linux, we say is not affected by virus, but then nobody can use it. Neither 4 year old nor 60 year old. Because I don't even know the first sentence or first instruction I have to type to get on the Linux. So now ultimately what will happen? The Linux and Windows will all appear like a same god, right? The wonderful software which anybody can use will have features of both combined. Finally, bottom line therefore is, my solution must have A good and B good. It is not OR. It is original problem appeared as if A or B. You can have high speed or less power, but it is always A and B. I want high speed as well as high power, which I know how to remove. Take example of supercomputers. So I was with Tata's, who started a supercomputer in 2006-07, and theirs was the fourth fastest at that time, 120 terahertz. What is in a supercomputer? I don't know, but I knew there are 1500 processors sitting there and consuming power like hell. And if you have got a bigger supercomputer now, petaflop, the flops is not an English word called flop. The petaflops are flip flop, like how many times it flips and flops, 10 raised to 15 times per second. It consumes 12 megawatt. So that means we require a power generating station right next to it. It is a hall like this size. 12 megawatt energy is being consumed in this hall. So first is how to distribute energy 12 megawatt in such a small area, and even bigger challenge is how to remove it. So give a contact to the Tata company, another Tata company, for cooling it. It was a horrendous job. First to dissipate the power, cables have to give that power and immediately remove it. So double job ho gaya. First dissipate it and then remove it, remove the heat. So now if we focus on removing the heat, so they have got this is the computer room. Triple this size, another room was required for the heat exchangers and all that cooling apparatus, like the full basement in our lecture theater, you can go down, you know, there is a big cooling system there, you know, making awful noise there. So, 3 times that size is the cooling apparatus required. So, if we take a view that removing the heat but not having such conventional cooling, then I will say cool it by liquid nitrogen. So, why should I have a liquid nitrogen plant? I have a liquid nitrogen which is an excellent cooler. So, I just get a tank every day and then that one tank is enough for cooling it for several hours or whatever. Why put a 12 megawatt generating station? We take it from a separate feeder from Tata's or Reliance. So, like that, you must avoid the unnecessary burden of solving the wrong problem. You know, installing this power station is a wrong problem, and removing the heat by using conventional cooling, Volta's like, is also a wrong problem. So, you must have the right solution. Get a feeder from the suppliers and use liquid nitrogen, and liquid nitrogen is not expensive because we unnecessarily think so. It is cheaper than the milk per liter. So, milk cost is some 16 rupees per half liter or 30 rupees a liter, it will be costing only 30 rupees a liter, but it will do a wonderful job in removing the, and then your supercomputer will work more efficiently because you are not unnecessarily burdened yourself with the wrong problem, otherwise you will be solving the wrong problem forever. So, we want A and B and not the burden of any one of them, A and B always. So, the conflict is either A or B, but we want a solution which is A and B. But today I am not trying to find the solution, I am only postulating the problem. So, second problem type, if I have an adjustable parameter, let us say C, then it happens like this. Suppose C is a parameter, at some high value it gives me some good function A, good. For example, if I am cleaning my job to be painted, which is the bonnet of my tractor, then cleaning is done by spraying some acid, 5% acid. So, you keep the concentration high, it cleans well. So, concentration of the acid, it cleans well, but then there is a problem, pollution, because once you have this spray and it bounces off this bonnet and then it creates a whole lot of mist, and then you have to have a special action for sucking it out, then you have to have a scrubber, and then you have to have a actual NOH, mix it with NOH to neutralize this acid, and all these requirements are coming. Why are they coming? Why are they not there till yesterday? Because now Mahindra and Mahindra want to be a world leader. If you want to be a world leader, you have to do all this. If you are sitting in China, you do not want to be a world leader, then you can do anything in there. You know, you can dump this acid in the drainage and it will take care of itself. That is what you think. But when you want to really solve the right problem, then pollution B is bad. So, if we keep the concentration low, for some reason I can even use 0.1% acid and get it properly cleaned, then the pollution is okay. Pollution problem, that is no pollution, good. But then cleaning itself is not good, cleaning poor. So, A bad. So, we have got A good, and then we have got B bad, and then we have got B good, and then A bad. But what we want is both A and B good. So, you know what is the solution? In that spray gun, you put electrostatic discharge and actuate this with a dry nitrogen, electrostatic discharge, and this electrostatic discharge goes with the acid and creates those independent ions or what you call the charges, and then they do much better cleaning. So, you can get it done with 0.1% HCl. So, only the gun has to be modified. So, that is the right solution. What is the right solution? I must do it with this. So, I do not have to do this scrubber and everything in it. This is fine. So, that is the right problem. Otherwise, you could have taken this and that would have been the wrong problem, because then you do this, then you have to remove it by exhaust, then you have to do scrubber action, dissolve all that in, treat with NaOH till it is neutralized and then send that outside. So you should not unnecessarily do the long drawn wrong problem correct solution business. So among these we have got two choices. One direction is the right problem. So therefore in the right problem you have identified, and if I now remove everything, just keep this. So I remove the jargon. So no jargon, meaning no details, just the English, right? It's just the English. There is a parameter. At one extreme, A is good but B is bad. Other extreme, B is good but A is bad. And now we have to find out which one is the right problem, because we ultimately want both A and B good. So this one is called mother of conflict. So this was two, sorry. So why is it mother of conflict? So C is the mother and A and B were the two children, which was the step one, right? Conflict between A and B. If I want a very high speed, then I have to put 12 megawatt power in, and B was that I have to again cool it. So A and B were the speed of the supercomputer and the B was a cooling problem. So there I did not say what was the root cause of it. So now I say that C. C is the mother, has got two children, and now you have to do best by both, and therefore this is called the mother of conflict. It gives a wonderful direction to your thesis. Not only you know which problem you have to solve, A good, B good, you also know where you begin. You begin at C, because C is the origin from where you can begin your solution. But I am not thinking about solution, I am just saying that it is a very good problem definition, because C also is a direction towards solution. So next lecture, you wake up next day, you will think about solution. Today we will only think about problem. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, exactly. No, that's okay. But as soon as I see such a diagram, one of the two must be a right problem.
Yeah. So yeah. You can see this right now in hindsight that this was the correct problem. But once you're beginning the problem, how would you identify?
So let me repeat it for the sake of recording. As he correctly says that because for that specific example, it was clear that this was a good solution. So now in the hindsight, we can say this is the mother of conflict. But what I'm saying is that this is a good diagram, which has all the necessary detail requirement of a good problem definition. I am not saying whether low is good or high is good. One of them will be okay. One of them is the right direction, one of them is the wrong direction. That's all I am saying. See, I have to give some example, no? Otherwise, you will not even understand what all this is happening. So the goodness of this is that if there is a big conflict, if I also have a inkling as to what is at the base of it, no? Then I have a possible direction to begin my activity. The third one is even more important. This is called elimination, eliminate the harm. So we see heat generated in that supercomputer as a harm, right? Or the pollution generated in that cleaning as a harm. The fly which has fallen in the teacup is the harm. Like that, there is something good, very clearly we know what is the harm. And therefore, it is very easy for us to simply make a statement that this is the harm and I must eliminate it. So the heating, whatever is happening, I must find the quickest way, cheapest way to eliminate that heat from the system, because the heat I require. To get the speed, I need to spend 12 megawatt, but heat is the harmful thing. When temperature rises, then there is a problem, like that. So same problem, I can look at it from all these three ways. That's what I'm saying, the same problem. So when we say eliminate the harm, it is like this. The diagram is graphical. So I give some energy to a thing called tool, and this is my object. So it acts on object. So hammer breaks rock, the supercomputer individual processors consume energy and therefore create heat. So electrical energy given to the supercomputer, that unit core or whatever you call it, creates heat when it goes to the final destination. But let us not dwell on that. The problem is, along with this good activity, there is a harm. So now there are exactly three ways of eliminating this harm mentally. So first is find the root cause and eliminate it. So many times the root cause is very, very difficult to find. For example, when you break a rock with a hammer, even how the rock gets broken by hammer hits, that analysis of that will depend on the place from where the rock has come and the structure of the rock, etcetera, etcetera, and it is a very complex problem. But if you can find it, you can do that. The second is find the action itself which causes the harm. But invariably the action actually is required to create the useful activity. For example, I have to supply that much energy to the supercomputer to get my speed, and therefore even if I know this is the action, I cannot eliminate it. I need that. The third one, very interestingly, is a eliminate only the effect of the harm. Okay, the heat is generated, 12 megawatt is converted to heat. We keep on saying, I don't want the heat, I don't want the heat, that's not enough. So we must ask the next question, what is the heat going to do? It is going to increase the temperature. If the temperature goes beyond 100 or whatever is the specification, the computer will shut itself off, rather it will get damaged. So usually it used to happen in our initial, early teething problems were these, that before we know, one or two or these, individual cores will stop working because they are getting heated. Then we have to worry about why the cooling is not efficient there. So the temperature rise due to the heat is the problem, right? So the effect of the harm in that case is the rise in temperature, and therefore we must focus on the heat removal. Therefore, the diagram now, I draw another diagram, actually it can be drawn just below it. So the rest of the thing remains same because I want the useful action. Which is the useful action? This is my tool, this is my object. Now to show that I have not eliminated the harm, I still draw this wiggle halfway. So this is a very good graphical representation of the problem. And then I have something, some other substance or some other activity which will, now on every activity like this, sorry for the space crunch, I have to draw it again here. The tool object is the useful action, the harm is still there, but now I have got this, some other material, and the verbs have to be here on this. So what does it do? Absorb or isolate or divert the harm. So that is what I am just going to take away, the heat out, and therefore this becomes my liquid nitrogen in this case. Because I want a ready-made cooler, I don't want the whole air conditioning system which occupies three times more space than this and takes a lot of footprint, and it is a headache to maintain it. So I keep the headache of giving liquid nitrogen to someone else, same way I keep the headache of providing 12 megawatts to somebody else, and I don't want to solve that problem. See, if I am having a problem with some metal pipe joint is leaking or has got porous, I don't go and start melting that and making pipes and all that, right? I have to find the right vendor for that, who gives me a pipe which is free of holes or voids, so like that. So nothing to be done on power side. I don't want to solve that wrong problem. I don't want to solve this wrong problem. I want to solve it by using ready-made coolant. I am just saying as an example. And therefore, this diagram, the good action has got a verb on it, the absorb, isolate, divert, this action has also got a verb on it, and therefore liquid nitrogen diverts the heat, right? This is the heat, that's it. Liquid nitrogen diverts heat. Unfortunately, I have gone into the solution mode, so let's remove this. For the next time, we are stuck with this problem here. So when you define the problem, you should simply draw this diagram and be happy that I have defined the correct problem. I must get rid of the harm. But the good English is, I must get rid of the effect of the harm, not get rid of the harm only. Because harm elimination causes me to change my technology. What we call, you have to resynthesize the whole thing. Somebody someday, IBM, I don't know, somebody someday will make this supercomputer by some other technology which uses some octajoule for every flip of 1 and 0. Right now it is giving me so much thing because every flipping is consuming some energy. So somebody goes three orders of order down for every flip that is. So they say optical computing may actually do that, reduce that energy for every one flip, 3 to 6 orders of magnitude lower, and then I will not generate this heat. So that means you have to resynthesize the whole thing to get the harm eliminated. Are you willing to do that? Resynthesize the whole thing. Make the supercomputer in a totally different way on new technology. That's too much in the future. But if you have to solve this problem, you have to only eliminate the effect of the, so that's the good English, eliminate the effect of the harm. So if I get a headache, do I go to a, sorry? Have you got any other lecture? I will just summarize because I don't want to unnecessarily overshoot. I will summarize now. I have got all this thing, I will just make a soft copy and upload with the help of Professor Arya. And yeah, so looking ahead, there are 5 levels of solution. So I am going to discuss in my next lecture. So first level, level 1, is called apparent solution. And it forms 30% of the patent database. So 30% of the patents are based on a single person's knowledge. Once he specifies the correct problem, he gets a patent, the right problem. The level 2 is minor modification. So putting instead of 1 core, putting 2 cores and 4 cores, as far as this method is concerned, is called a minor modification. For Intel it may be a major modification, but for a user it is just a minor thing. Instead of 1 core, now you have got a 2 core, 4 core like that. Because you have got already a existing good process, you just put 2 of them because you have the nanometer sizes are reducing. So 65 nanometer node has now gone to 32, the 32 will go down to further smaller, so you can put 4 of them. So that's called minor modification. Level 3 is called major modification. That's only 11 to 12%. The fourth is very important, is called paradigm shift. What is the paradigm shift for supercomputer? Are we going to multiply 2 numbers of 60 bits each or things like that forever? No, we can do quantum computing, totally different thing. You can do optical computing, of course, doing the multiplication exactly the conventional way, but use the optical computer for doing that. But quantum computing is totally different. So that's called paradigm shift. The level 5 is new discovery. So you may yet win a Nobel Prize for for this. So the fellow who invented or made the integrated circuit first in 1958 got a Nobel Prize in 2000. So in TIFR they used to say not only you have to do great work, you have to have long life, you know, you have to be alive to get it, because they may give to you after 40, 50 years. So what is the significance of such solutions? This solution goes to conference papers, this goes to top journals, this may go into, maybe this or this will go into Nature or Science or whatever you think is wonderful. This one nobody knows, we cannot prepare for that. So I think summarizing, you have to use good English to define the right problem, particularly in the case of harm elimination. The good English is eliminate the effect of the harm, not the harm itself. And several are mainly solutions, and I think in your entire research career for PhDs, all these will be valid as you progress. For M.Tech student, I think you must aim at one each. A 6 months work must get you these two publications. You deserve it. The guide wants it, but you deserve it. All that you have to do is define the right problem right at the beginning. And when should you finish this work? Before November, before the placement begins. After the placement, nobody does anything. So before that itself, in the summer itself, you should finish. Are some of you in the second semester of M.Tech? Right? So define, please define the problem before the semester ends and solve it in the summer vacation. That's it. If you define the right problem, solve it in the summer vacation, everything is achieved. You deserve those two papers, and the guide wants it, so he also gets it. So thank you very much. One more session on how to, having defined a tough problem, how to solve it. Okay.